Greetings, Guardians. My name is Bife here. In the last video, I talked about the nature of Bungie's communications problem, and that was all well and good, but in this episode, we're going to be covering something a little more tangible. It's still something, however, that's very close to my heart, so expect a lot of passion on this. The entire concept for a video of this nature started when I noticed a Destiny player called Iron Lord and their amazing artwork. They had basically sent me into a bit of a fever dream by creating a mocked up version of what the grimoire might look like if it was put in game. For those of you that don't know, the grimoire is basically like Destiny's backstory and lore as told through a series of cards that you unlocked as you played Destiny 1. It's an astounding collection of written works, some factual and to the point others being more like journal entries, all of them, however, telling the greater story of Destiny's universe. It was at this point that I saw a tweet from Deej regarding the things that were being done for the lore community, namely just a few more comics and other stuff coming up in Expansion 2. I then politely replied, petitioning him for an archive tab, at which point that tweet kind of blew up. And it was then that I knew I wanted to talk about this for one of my upcoming videos on how to improve Destiny. A few key points before we start. Once again, I encourage you all to add your suggestions to the comments section below. I already noted that I was missing a section which showed off the scannables, so what I'm going to suggest is by no means completely comprehensive. I'm also going to go ahead and ask that you're all as constructive as usual. Trust me, I get the irritated comments. I'm right there with you on them. The state of the game infuriates me as much as it infuriates you all, but if we're going to improve it, sadly, we can't necessarily lend as much voice to those as we'd like. We need feedback to reach these guys, and their ears, not something where it's just a massive bag of salt. Trust me though, I have a pretty big salt heap that I'm sitting on myself, so I'm right there with you guys. Once again, I need to also provide a little disclaimer of, I'm not a developer, but... ellipses. In this case, I think, once again, it's very important because the majority of this video is going to be using visual aids as a means of demonstrating a point, and is going to primarily be a challenge for the UI designers at Bungie. I don't know how big that challenge is going to be, however, a lot of the suggestions work within the scale and scope of what we've seen in Destiny 1 previously. You'll notice that we make particularly common use of the record book format for this purpose. And before anything else is said, I want everyone to also note that a lot of this is a pipe dream. And on the lore front in particular, there's a lot more pressure to fill in other parts of the game as opposed to this. We are a smaller community, perhaps, than the PvP crowd, but we're also a lot less vocal. So if you are a member of the lore community or have any interest, this is the point at which you should be shouting the loudest. It's unlikely that we'll see many of these suggestions get implemented right away, but all the same, this is something for Bungie to see and to think about, hopefully. Something that I hope is helpful to them. So, let's talk a little bit about the problems we have in Destiny 2 and the problem that I wanted to address in this video, which in this case is actually a problem that has stuck around since Destiny 1. Bungie's writers have made a fantastical universe. That's not the problem. This is a universe that deserved to have its story told, within the game, in a fleshed out and robust manner. However, the major problem is that this doesn't happen anywhere near as much as it could and should. Back in Destiny 1, it was a far greater issue, seeing as you needed to go to a third-party website to look up the grimoire, which held the majority of the lore for the game. Combine this with what was already a pretty shallow story, and you get a game that had memes created around it. A game that probably didn't deserve it. One of the biggest suggestions from reviewers at the time was to add the grimoire to the game so we didn't have to open a third-party website to find out what's going on. Come Destiny 2, Bungie had sort of half-acted on this by putting all of Destiny 2's accompanying lore into the items that Destiny 2 would allow you to collect, in the form of lore tabs. Now, this works pretty well for what it is, and the lore tabs are a great addition to the game, but they still don't paint a complete picture. Bungie's statement of, "We're putting the lore in the game," is only half true at best, considering that they neglected to find a way of putting all of the various lore from the past 3 years of Destiny 1 into the game as well. So let's be clear. No, Bungie, you didn't put the lore in the game, you put some of the lore in the game. So, why didn't they bring the grimoire over? Well, I think the answer may have sadly had something to do with the bad associations it had garnered, and listening to too much data as opposed to player suggestions. Keep in mind that this, of course, is all postulation and speculatory, so I do not know the real reasons as to why it was not carried over. For all I know, it could have been way too much work to put this in there, but for the moment, I want to go ahead and expand on those two reasons that I just mentioned because I feel like they may have been more likely. We're going to start with the bad associations one. In the outer circles of the gaming community that didn't really get involved in Destiny 1, the grimoire was seen as this sort of dirty word, like some kind of aberration that shouldn't exist. It's entirely possible that Bungie wanted to part from that negative association, hence why the grimoire was also needlessly removed from Bungie.net at the launch of Destiny 2. Another important point might well be that this was a data-driven decision. Bungie might have looked at the vast amount of time that was being put into the writing of the grimoire and might have seen that not as many people were reading it as were encountering other parts of the Destiny experience, be they in the game or on Bungie.net. Now, to the first point, the negative association thing, I think that there is no substitute for being brave about it. You see, the reason the grimoire had a dirty word association wasn't because of the fact that it was a story about Destiny. Nobody really hated the lore. It was simply the fact that it was relegated to being outside the game. Its presence on Bungie.net was what really made it a laughingstock. As for the data-driven point, I can also see a motive here for Bungie. They may well have interpreted the lack of people visiting the grimoire as a lack of interest generally, but I think there's a few really important notes to make here. Firstly, again, there was the effect of putting it online as opposed to in the game. This made it less accessible, and this I think is a big part of the reason why the numbers behind Destiny's grimoire usage might have been so low. In addition, we need to look at the fact that many people are actually very interested in Destiny's lore, but don't go into the grimoire to get it. There are other sites like IshtarCollective.net that have formatted themselves in a far better way than Bungie's grimoire section on Bungie.net, and of course, if you want to talk about the real notion of a thriving lore community, you only need to look as far as general players talking about the game world and the things that they don't know. When I sat down with Lucky and BW, for example, on one of their streams and discussed the lore behind the Trials of Osiris, it was because they genuinely were interested in the lore that had been made somewhat inaccessible to them, and yet they had been playing Trials for years and had never really heard any of this. As a result, they'd heard all of these urban myths and stray pieces of information pertaining to the cult and Osiris, but had never probably had the time to look into it. And can anyone blame them when it was stuck on Bungie.net and they're, more importantly, doing their job, helping people run through the trials? The interest is there in many tangents of the community, it's simply not cultivated properly, and people aren't given an incentive to go and look at the lore. Looking beyond my own anecdotal evidence though, r/DestinyLore is its own subreddit with a community of people constantly working to discuss topics on deeper matters. And if I have to make such a blunt point and one that throws myself into the situation, you might want to take a look at myself, Mylan Games, Sir Wallen, Terramantis, Beard Grizzly, DSR and DBM Gamer, and so many other channels that have dedicated themselves to Destiny's lore. This really is an expansive community, and one that garnered quite a bit of hype, I might say, as well. One of the major points, I think, for people just before Destiny 2 was an hour and a half video that I made breaking down the entirety of Destiny 1's story, including the backstory that had not necessarily been portrayed in the grimoire. And all of this garnered me 1.7 million views. So to anybody who says that there is no interest in the lore and the backstory of the game, I present to you my own data, and I present to you the principles under which data there may not necessarily have provided the correct idea. To be quite frank about it, running data on the grimoire activity on Bungie.net would be like trying to measure the pace of an Olympic 100-meter sprinter whilst they have a broken leg. The test was basically set up for failure from the start. Now let's also be clear, the grimoire isn't the only source of problems in the world of Destiny. It's also the approach it takes to the world and how you build it and embrace that lore. Scannables, for example, provide amazing little insights into the world of Destiny, but they're not stored anywhere, they're not sorted. You need to return to each scannable and the location of it every single time if you want to hear it again, and Lord forbid if you've forgotten where it is or it's inside a mission zone which you can't activate. Not to mention there's no way of tracking which ones you have and haven't found, so you might miss some altogether and have no incentive to search for them. All of this makes me relate back to Destiny 1 and how the game had an almost Dark Souls-esque way of treating the lore in the game, a sort of show-don't-tell approach. Now that works great for Dark Souls because the whole world is steeped in mystery, but Destiny is somewhere in between this and a more traditional attempt at storytelling, which ends up being totally infuriating because it takes the worst aspects of both methods and combines them into this kind of monster child. You can't have a narrative and cinematic campaign whilst also trying to keep the workings of a universe completely secret to the point of being completely unreasonable with your player base. The pendulum has to swing from the other direction on this one. Less Dark Souls and more kind of Mass Effect, much as that is an overused example. Now, it should also be noted that I'm not saying we should hear everything in an hour's worth of exposition. I'm not saying that the team should just start to tell us the deepest secrets of Destiny's storyline, and I'm not telling them to spell it out for us. I am, however, asking them to make these stories more accessible to the masses of people that really might be interested in them but have never had a chance to look into them more because they've been cut off at every turn. So, with all that said, our problem is best summarized like this. Destiny's universe is expansive and excellently crafted, but the game has always done a poor job of making the lore accessible for players, and also does a poor job of translating how well the world is built into the game itself. On top of this, players have no extra incentive to go and search for the lore. So, what's our solution? Well, you remember that one tweet I made to Deej asking him politely if we could have an archive tab? Iron Lord reposted all of his grimoire in-game concepts there, and that really got me thinking about how to do it. It was at that moment when I sat down and talked with NFS International. For those of you who don't know, NFS is a bit of a legend for creating a bunch of exotic weapon concepts in Destiny, essentially dissecting weapons from within the game and putting them back together to create something new and very exciting. Think of him like the Destiny weapon equivalent of Frankenstein, except all of his creations look really good and, well, you know, feel like they might fit within the universe. Again, this is a testament to the skill of NFS and his work. You can find his Twitter and some other links to his work in the description down below, by the way, check him out. More recently, he's been working on a lot of little bits and bobs that were very similar to what I was thinking of, in the same vein of trying to work and help improve the game through constructive critique and suggestions to the developers. So I decided to team up with NFS and help bring my vision to life as a result. The final conclusion of all of this is as follows. Welcome to the Archive. A way of helping build the world, make the lore and story more accessible, and also adding some small amounts of auxiliary progression for players to do so, involving them in the grimoire and the game more generally. Now, before we go into this and explain each section, book by book, I need to preface this again by saying that I don't think all of this will be added. I'm in fact doubtful because a lot of what I've suggested here might well have been brought up in Bungie before. I also want to point out that there are any number of plot MacGuffins that could be used to introduce this, however. Discovering an old Warmind vault, recovering lost records from the city's destruction, even just finding them in a Golden Age cache that we unlock somewhere. There are a lot of places to introduce this into the game. It doesn't feel like something that would be hard to introduce as any plot point is concerned. I think it's simply a point of gameplay, implementation, and the UI designers. Anyway, let's start looking into the archive that I drew up with NFS and look into what it contains. So, first of all, the archive tab itself is deliberately placed past the clan section so as not to obstruct quick invitations to clans or to block any inventory management stuff that players might have going on. Going to the archive would very much be a deliberate choice, but there will be incentives for players to go there, which we'll talk about in a few minutes' time. We broke the archive down into six different categories with the room for more books to be added. All of these will provide relevant knowledge to help players explore the world of Destiny. These six sections, at the moment, include the Path to Enlightenment, Cinematics, the Grimoire, the Codex, the Arsenal, and Collectibles. Let's start off with something more for the junior lore nerds, namely the Codex. This is your quick and dirty explanatory section. There are four codex tabs labeled characters, places, events, and objects. These tabs are each designed to give about 4 to 5 sentences worth of backstory to each individual object, character, event, or place mentioned. This helps new players familiarize themselves with the world around them. The inspiration for all of this really came from this moment from Angry Joe's review of Destiny 2 that makes a really important point.
With so many characters, and now expansions, to keep track of, I needed some kind of reference material.
What's it gonna try this time around? When I hear about the Dust Palace and those Scion Flayers getting into Rasputin's mind, I wonder, what would they talk about? Rasputin?
Who the fuck is Rasputin?
You see, that moment where a character is mentioned to Angry Joe could have been a really great moment for him to visit a codex section and look up a simple reference about who Rasputin is. However, none exists, and this is part of the problem. This is for those that really want to understand the story in a quick and dirty fashion, people that want a base knowledge that is accurate, but at the same time isn't going to drown them in long words like I would in one of my lore videos. So, what else would be in the codex section? Well, the Codex would also include some clearly important characters, such as the 3 Vanguard commanders, Dominus Gaul, Amanda Holiday, etc., etc. But you could also include some basic overviews of key events mentioned in the game. For example, at 1 or 2 points in the continuity, when the Battle of the Twilight Gap is mentioned. Lend a few sentences to that moment in the events section, and you could potentially improve people's understanding of what went on. You could also have a look closer into areas such as the EDZ or Titan's Arcology in the Places section. Not to mention that of course you can have little blurbs on previous locations in Destiny, be they Mars, Venus, the Dreadnought, or even the Cosmodrome. The Items section, to finish off, could talk about all sorts of things. For example, what are those things that Osiris is holding in the first cutscene for Curse of Osiris? I don't want to call them lore fidget cubes, I don't want to see those things relegated to a place of nothing. I want to know what those are and what they do. So, yeah, tell me some more about that, and hopefully that makes things better for the game. And it also helps players to understand what's going on and why things are so important. Old items that you could include in this include things such as the Sword of Crota, which is key to the Dark Below expansion, or you could go as far back as to look to the Taken King and do Willbreaker and the shard that breaks off from it, which you use to forge your own crystal. You could even have Siva fragments in there, which help explain the Siva crisis from Rise of Iron. There's a lot of potential for this, and considering that each of them is a short section, you don't necessarily need a lot of stuff here to make it really, really engaging and really helpful for players. Next up, let's talk about the one you all expected. The Grimoire. Yes, there's a little overlap here with the Codex, but to be honest, that I think is totally fine considering that the Grimoire itself has a lot of unique stuff intact that you can't find anywhere else. The Books of Sorrow, for example, are a complete set of 52 cards that are self-contained within the Grimoire, and they are an amazing story. That is no small feat. The Book of Sorrows is, quite frankly, one of the Destiny universe's greatest accomplishments in terms of storytelling. So, with such great stories inside the Grimoire, there was a very simple premise that had to be put forward. Add it to the game. All of it. Even the seemingly inconsequential cards, such as cards for the different melee attacks or cards for Glimmer, give us important little insights into the world of Destiny that wouldn't otherwise be available. For the lore community, adding the Grimoire to the game is also one of the most commonly made requests. Consider that the Grimoire, for years, has been the most commonly used primary source for anybody trying to look up stuff on Destiny lore. Whether that's something that's done through Ishtar Collective, whether it's something sourced in a YouTube video, or whether it's something where a person has on that rare occasion gone to Bungie.net. Another important point is that the Grimoire here would be complete regardless of your score from Destiny 1, although we'll still be talking about those that got a near complete Grimoire score later down the line and what rewards will be in place for you and what incentive there will be for veterans to return. Next up though, I want to codify all of the lore that we have in Destiny 2 in one place as well, and we're doing that in the Arsenal tab. You see, lore tabs work for what they are, but they're a little bit ham-handed. Not only do you need to have the item on you at that time, but the items you don't use regularly may never get read at all. Meaning that what you know any lore about may entirely depend upon the meta or what your favorite weapon is, and you might not discover some of the cool stories hidden within. So, the Arsenal tab is a place where you can look into any of the weapons, armor, ghost, or ships or gear that you've gathered. You can tab over to look at each set, and as a result, all the gear gets more equal chances to shine. In addition, there's the added benefit of helping to keep all of the stories from specific parts of the lore together by grouping armor and weapons into relevant sections for that particular category. For example, a raid section containing all the armor and weapons from the Leviathan activities will help better tell the stories of the Imperial Shadows, and a trials section could contain all the gear from Trials of the Nine, helping you understand their story. Aside from anything else, it just makes the entire system a lot more coherent for everybody who is working around endgame activities, and people who raid or do trials will also have a running tally of what gear they do and don't have, just by looking at the Arsenal page. It serves two functions in this respect. Next up, collectibles, which actually came up in conversation with Christopher Barrett fairly recently. Chris was asked by a fan on Twitter if Dead Ghosts would be returning, and as a result, he stated that there would be more collectibles and things to search for returning to Destiny. This was the point at which I looked to my fellow writer Oz for a little inspiration. I had the idea that collectibles could be added again, you know, this kind of separate Dead Ghosts section, although admittedly Chris has stated that Dead Ghosts won't be specifically returning. Oz, however, came up with an idea that was rather brilliant, the reintroduction of artifacts. Now, I know what you're thinking if you're a Destiny 1 veteran, but hear me out. For those of you that don't know, artifacts in Destiny 1 provided little more than small stat boosts and a little tidbit of lore every single time that you looked at one. This was only available in short amounts of flavor text and really didn't give us much of an insight into anything about the world of Destiny. However, they were really cool. Aside from the Iron Lord ones, however, you really didn't see artifacts making much of an effect on the game, and as a result, many people will just remember them with a resounding meh. Therefore, they would return, but in a completely different capacity, as new collectibles that would help add depth to the world and give lost sectors more of a purpose. The idea that Oz and I basically came up with, although this is primarily his, I give him a huge amount of credit for, is this. Let's say that you land on Io and you see a cave entrance. In no time at all, you realize that you found a lost sector, namely the Grove of Ulan Tan. This is a real lost sector in-game, by the way, so if you want to go ahead and visit that for yourself, you can understand where all of this might play in. Now, the name and significance here should already be somewhat obvious. Ulan Tan is indeed a person, but for those of you that are more versed in the lore, you may specifically remember that they are a famous warlock. Now imagine this. Inside this lost sector, as well as the chest which you can loot after killing the boss, there is always one hidden collectible artifact. It could be anywhere in the lost sector, so look around keenly and scout every corner, you never know where it's going to be. For the sake of this example, we decided to arbitrarily place this artifact on the rocks here. Once located, the artifact can be picked up and added to your archive. Once collected, it doesn't use up inventory space like, say, tokens would or anything else of that manner, but instead has its own sorted category in the archive. Each artifact will be related to the lost sector in question and will give a little more context to the lost sector you found it in, which could then be read in a lore tab-like format. For example, the artifact from the Grove of Ulan Tan here that we mocked up tells us a little bit more about Ulan Tan's philosophy and his life. A small note here, by the way, the lore here is mostly accurate, but this is purely for demonstration purposes. Do not take anything about Ulan Tan's early life here that we've written as canon. This is just for demonstration. So you can see that these artifacts act in a similar manner to Dead Ghosts, but really have a chance to do so much more in terms of world building and making lost sectors just a little more relevant. Let's also be clear that this is not a long-term solution for lost sectors being underused and imperfect, that's certainly for sure. But this does mean that there's potentially a chance for more identity to these places that are in other, less exciting cases, just a cave with some dudes in them. Potentially, more important than this is the fact that these artifacts would have tangible progression attached to them. More on that a little bit later. Oz initially coined the term lore-tifacts for these new collectibles and even suggested that they had the potential to go even further. It's clear that more could be done here, such as putting them throughout the world as well as lost sectors, but Oz was thinking much bigger on this front. His ideas included collecting certain artifacts and triggering secret exotic quests by doing so. These could yield weapons of incredible power related to the artifacts that you had uncovered. This is a little similar to the Dvalin relics from Destiny's Taken King expansion, which resulted in the Sleeper Simulant. These were relics that you found all over the place, just dropped off of enemies, and when you collected all of them, after a certain threshold, the quest would begin. And it did result in a very powerful weapon that was definitely worth the payoff. All of this was stuff that we didn't throw out and illustrate for the sake of time, but it gives you a good idea of what the potential of a Lortifact-based system could look like. Now, we're almost done here, but we need to talk about one of the penultimate tabs that we didn't discuss earlier, the Cinematics tab, the least focused intensive edition. Quite simply, this would be a place to rewatch all of the previous cinematics that you've unlocked. Nothing fancy here, but it gives people a reason to jump into the archive, and to be honest, this is an expected feature from most RPGs. And I think that Destiny's cutscenes are criminally underused. The number of times I've gone back and rewatched the final cutscene from Destiny 2 on YouTube is pretty staggering, to be honest. So yeah, that hopefully gives you guys a good idea of why this should be in here. And finally, I wanted to save what I think is the best for last. This is the Path to Enlightenment. So what is this last book? Well, it's kind of a mix of the Grimoire Score, a massive record book to track progression and a way of properly incorporating endgame rewards into expansion content and those that really want to collect the lore. This, I'm hoping, is an unintrusive way of doing so as well, and something that helps players to grind as they enjoy the game. This one was very much more about providing a progression incentive with the lore than it was about providing unique pieces of lore itself. But not only this, it fit the theme as well with the whole book aspect that we'd already been running with. And for a new Destiny 2 version of the Grimoire Score to exist alongside it, it felt natural. In this case, there was a factor of progression that some players could look to max, and would reward veteran players especially with unique rewards on cosmetic and material lines. Nothing, however, that would put Destiny 2 new players back, to an extent that might be considered unfair. So, to give a quick rundown, the Path to Enlightenment does the following things. Firstly, it provides a section that gives players unique rewards for compiling their archive, tying the lore into gameplay and the loop of Destiny's endgame progression. Secondly, it provides a score-based progression system that can be increased for completing a multitude of actions within Destiny 2 and Destiny 1. This would be because the score would roll both a player's old Grimoire score and a new score system, specifically for objectives in Destiny 2, together. This would create a single cumulative score, a new score that would be referred to as Enlightenment. Thirdly, the Path to Enlightenment would provide pinnacle endgame goals for players to accomplish. Accomplishing these goals would ultimately grant the player pinnacle endgame gear and rewards that would in themselves be worth grinding for. The next point is that these rewards from the book are fixed, no RNG unless otherwise stated. For example, a few of the rewards include fated engrams, the same kind that you get from Xur, so that you know that you are indeed getting the engram. The Path to Enlightenment achievements unlock after level 20, and until the story campaign is completed, all achievements are left as classified. Finally, rewards would be granted to players who have also invested time in Destiny 1 to raise their Grimoire score, as well as those that have played only in Destiny 2. Rewards that would require players to go back to Destiny 1 and max their Grimoire would never be more than a few material gains and some unique cosmetics. Players completing current Destiny 2 content would still get access to material rewards as well as unique weapons, cosmetics, armor, and materials that would help all players progress. To provide an example of how this would work, I want to show you a few achievement pages that NFS and I mocked up. First of all, we're checking in here at page 1, where the general Path to Enlightenment score achievements can be found. As you can see, as you gain more enlightenment, the achievement increases, and you get more of the emblem unlocking. This was a very deliberate choice. We had an emblem here which luckily evolved over time, so it just looks really good too. Each of these particular milestones is obtainable by increasing one's enlightenment score as seen on the right. Arbitrarily, we set the value of enlightenment to 10,000 for demonstration purposes. This is simply to indicate that enlightenment at a certain point in Destiny 2 might reach into the tens of thousands and that kind of five-figure benchmark. Having said that, this is something which will grow with every player's accomplishments. These first two pages here, on the path to enlightenment, chart general score goals and provide substantial rewards for completing each one. They'll start relatively small though, and they will be mundane, but they are built to scale with your level. For example, your first 1,000 enlightenment will fly by and would probably be accomplished easily when you've completed the Destiny 2 campaign. This would allow you to get the first achievement called Apprentice for 500 enlightenment, which rewards you with something really small, like 5,000 glimmer and 3 rare engrams at light level. Something to boost you, but nothing that gives you a huge advantage at the time. Meanwhile, getting 3,000 would boost you even further with a pair of legendary engrams at light level, as well as unique rewards. These rewards would increase as time goes on. Players can either max their scores in Destiny 2 and still get rewarded quite handsomely, or they can be rewarded in equal measure for having fully fleshed out their grimoire as a Destiny 1 player. Now keep in mind, those rewards are placeholder, so yeah, things could be better or worse or anything within that ballpark, and I also know that right now rewards in Destiny need a sandbox overhaul. But stick with me for a moment, we're looking at carrots on the end of sticks, not how the carrots taste right now. At the very peak of these rewards would be achievements for maximizing your enlightenment score across the possible set of expansions. This includes achievements such as the Osirian Ascendant achievement, which would be a score threshold that rewards players who have completed all possible enlightenment goals and maximized their enlightenment scores for the Curse of Osiris expansion. The rewards we had in mind for completing this particular achievement included an aura effect for the expansion, which is unique to it and aesthetically is appropriate. This would, however, be permanent. It would not go away after a week. It would also include an exotic class item, an exotic ship, exotic sparrow, a unique artifact, and a fated engram, aka an exotic engram which contains a guaranteed exotic that you've not earned before. So you can see that the rewards would probably be worth grinding for, but they're not giving players anything past unique cosmetic upgrades and some power in some cases. The nice thing, however, is also that they are rewarded for their mastery and prowess of the game. And also, these achievements can be attained retroactively. So let's say that Destiny 2 rolls on for another couple of years, and a player finally reaches the required enlightenment score to get that Osirian Ascendant goal. You would then just be able to unlock that even if you've not played Destiny 1. So there is always something to work towards for a player, even if they haven't jumped into Destiny 1. Note also that on the second page, we left room below the score markers that we have added thus far. This is not a mistake. This is something that I think would be necessary to allow Bungie to add more score markers, more objectives, and of course, more possibilities for players to obtain higher rewards as new expansions and experiences are added to Destiny 2. We also took the time to celebrate Destiny veteran players by giving them their own Legend section, which specifically rewards and tracks milestones completed in Destiny 1, giving small rewards such as emblems based on your progress here. For example, we've got rewards for finding the two epic hidden exotic quests, Outbreak Prime and Touch of Malice, the ones associated with the raids. We've also got achievements for completing every single story boss and every single raid boss, as well as a lot of endgame achievements. I was very hesitant about putting Trials of Osiris in here with the Lighthouse Run and Rank 5 Iron Banner for the simple reason that they're no longer active in Destiny 1, but this still provides some unique rewards for Destiny 1 completionists, and you can get an idea of what would be awarded. As an example, those that finished the Rise of Iron story campaign would unlock the Young Wolf achievement, granting them an emblem and a unique artifact known as the Shattered Howl, which is basically the remains of the sword that Saladin presented you at the end of the story campaign. You can see again that artifacts are tied into this book as part of the progression. Artifact collection, by the way, would have its own section, but we'll talk about that in just a second. Now, what about players that didn't play Destiny 1, I hear you asking? Well, the good news is that you get access to a whole lot more pages and achievements that come with those pages that will provide unique rewards such as weapons and armor that will impact your gameplay experience. This is the real cream of the crop. This is the point at which the most incredible rewards are being cordoned off. It's making sure that Destiny 1 veterans still get really unique and cool cosmetics, as well as stuff to grind for, but at the same time, it's rewarding everyone who picks up Destiny 2 and allows you to obtain things for doing most of the activities that Destiny 2 provides. There would be pages for Strikes, The Crucible, Trials of the Nine, Iron Banner, Faction Rallies, Raids, Titan, Warlock and Hunter progression, the collection of artifacts or other collectibles, finding scannables, exploring lost zones, completing adventures, and etc. There would also be unique pages for each expansion. Take a look, for example, at the Curse of Osiris page that we drew up. This page includes 8 achievements, with a separate achievement tracked elsewhere for completing all objectives. The achievements include completing the campaign, killing 5,000 Vex, completing the Saint 14 quest, completing 25 adventures on Mercury, yes, you'd have a reason to do those, hallelujah, getting all 11 Forge weapons, completing 50 Crucible matches on Curse of Osiris maps, completing 3 Prestige Nightfalls on Curse of Osiris strikes, and the Belly of the Beast achievement for completing the Eater of Worlds raid lair. Now, to give an example of how rewards would work, I want to look at 2 of these achievements. Firstly, I want to look at the Curse Bearer achievement for completing all of these 8 Curse of Osiris milestones, and the Laid to Rest achievement for completing the Saint 14 quest. The rewards for completing all of the Osiris milestones, for example, and getting that Curse Bearer achievement, would include a unique emblem, a unique Osiris-themed weapon, 10 Masterwork Cores, 50,000 Glimmer, a legendary Ghost Shell, a unique armor set based off of the Osiris aesthetic, especially for Warlocks who would look to borrow very heavily from Osiris's own armor design, and a unique lore artifact related to Osiris. So that's the kind of reward that players expect from completing the base endgame content in Curse of Osiris. But what about the Saint 14 quest? Well, as many of you know, you already get the Perfect Paradox Shotgun and Legend of Saint 14 emblem for completing the quest. By the way, it irritates the hell out of me that a emblem with legend in the title is not a legendary emblem. It's only a rare. Come on, guys, fix that up. Anyway, the whole point of bringing up the Saint 14 quest is that it made a very interesting idea occur, namely the idea that Bungie could make good on their promises of adding endgame content that could previously only be found in Eververse to avenues that could be attained in gameplay. With this, I thought about the potential of having the Saint 14 ship, known as Saint 14's Grey Pigeon, alongside the other 2 rewards in this record book. This would just give you an example of how Bungie could tie in all of that loot that's currently locked up in the Eververse store. Finally, you can also clearly see that this is all displayed on the front page of the record book, which now, instead of having generic milestones, can be looked into as a guide for what to do next at a glance. The 12 icons at the top indicate the rewards of the 12 closest uncompleted milestones, and at the bottom, you can select an uncompleted milestone within the record book to place it here as a tracked milestone that would also appear in your UI when you bring up your ghost. All of this is not only providing players with a whopping huge amount of incentive to go and stick their heads into the lore, but also provides a more solid base for the progression system in Destiny. And let's be clear, this isn't perfect right now, because A, it's something I drew up out of my head and has not been done with any kind of emphasis towards real game design balance, so who knows, maybe I've done something and this is completely lopsided. But more so than that, right now, there's an ongoing sandbox issue, which is something I want to talk about later down the line. Long story short, weapons feel underwhelming and rewards generally in Destiny aren't worth it. This, of course, all assumes that that problem has been fixed, and I hope that a system like this is something that would eventually be what could provide rewards and incentives to real Destiny veterans, who could really use some love at this point. Finally, I want to touch on one final point once more. Will any of this happen? Maybe. Maybe not. All I aim to do here is to suggest ways in which Bungie can finally solve the long-standing problems of the lore in the game not being engaging enough for some, and not being accessible enough for others. As they say, those that ask for nothing receive nothing. And so, this is my polite petition to the developers at Bungie to add this as a way of bringing the world together more cohesively. I hope the suggestion is helpful, and as for those of you that are watching this video, I hope that you enjoyed it. If you did, feel free to leave a comment down below, add further suggestions on how this idea could be improved, or have your own ideas in the comment section down below. Right now, Bungie is being much more receptive than they were in the past, so now is the time to really throw suggestions at them. If Bungie employees look at this, they might scroll into the comment section for inspiration on ideas that they have in the game right now, or to see the reception of this idea later down the line. I also want you guys to go ahead and check out NFS International and some of his work. He really does some amazing concept stuff with all of the weapons, and this video certainly wouldn't have been possible without him. In addition, you can do all the typical stuff such as leaving a like and also subscribing, and of course you can also hit the bell next to subscribe in order to turn on email notifications if you feel so inclined. But of course, your viewership as always is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Per audacia ad astra. I'll see you, Starside.